Can you hear me?
Hi. Yeah.
Hi. So thank you all for thank you all for joining the webinar session. So sorry for starting a little late. We have some issues in the technical things. So we have with us Chirag Jain from Google. So Chirag Jain works on JavaScript infrastructure at Google. So prior to joining Google, Chirag worked with Uber. So Chirag has very sound knowledge in JavaScript. Thank you, Chirag. Thanks for joining. So over to you.
Yeah. Thank you for the nice introduction. Yeah, and shout out to the Google folks for reaching out and scheduling this. So, yep. So everybody is able to see the screen, right? The slides?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So the talk is about a deep dive in web architecture. So this won't be anything framework specific or even like going that deep in JavaScript. We'll basically talk a lot about how web applications basically work, what you would find common in most of, in all of the web applications. And so that when you go out after the session, at the end of the session, you basically take out some reusable concepts or tools in your kitty that you can use with any framework that you are that you are using for your project. So yep, and feel free to interrupt and like ask questions in between. I want to keep it pretty interactive. So yeah, coming back to the topic. So a deep dive in web architecture. When we talk about web applications these days, a lot has changed in the last decade. From simple HTML from simple documents of just some text on the page, we have come so far that there are online games now, and you can also edit photos on the web and whatnot. So with all this, a lot of responsibilities also fall down to the developers, because every user isn't roaming around with a flagship phone, and data costs money, and in different regions, people cannot afford like download. So the primary use case for web is it allows zero cost onboarding. Basically, so the user can just open a URL and start using your application. Whereas for native apps, they have to go into an app store, download the app, sign up, and then the thing starts. So overall, the cold start for web apps is pretty low because it has such a large reach. It is our responsibility to make the experience or the apps we make to make them performant so that everybody they reach, they can access them. So yeah, so we'll start with one of the topics would be networks. So like this is the backbone of the web from the CERN days. So as we talked about, network is not free. Everybody doesn't have a like Gbps, so 1 Gbps connection, and data costs a lot of money. There, like people buy data, like just think of 3 years back when Jio wasn't there, how expensive was data? And each time the user opens your app, they spend some money, even if it's not going to you. So we need to think about that. There's an inherent cost when the users are accessing your app. So how we can like work with that? So we'll talk about different parts of the network. So yep. So as we talked about, there are two parts to this. One is bandwidth and another is payload size. So because everybody doesn't have a has a really fast connection, your app won't load in the same time for everybody. And the second is payload size, the total minimum size of minimum data the user will need to download for to use your app. And for a certain amount of data, they need to pay their ISP a certain value. So it is actually monitor. It matters both on the user experience side and also on the financial aspect of your application. So this can affect. So there have been studies around this. So a recent study, a study done some time back basically said if a web page takes more than 15 seconds to load, then the users will just close the app and go to another site. So that is the kind of traffic we are dealing with. So it is also an advantage that your product will have it if it optimizes for network. Going down. So the first thing I want to discuss is HTTP caching. As web applications are delivered over HTTP, so this is one of the core mechanisms that the platform provides you already. So you can have a lot of control. This is kind of the most highest ROI thing you can do for your application with minimal code change. This just requires you to add some headers to your web server configuration, and then basically it would be cached on the client side, and the next time the page loads or the resource is requested, the client wants to needs that resource, it will use it from the cache rather than from requesting it from the server. So just by adding like changing some configurations on your web server, you can improve the experience for the user and also cut down on your bandwidth cost for your server. So some of the HTTP headers would be MaxSage, cache control, and there's also something called there's etags, which are used to track the version of the resource. So there's a lot you can do around it. So you get a lot of control using like two or three headers overall on your cache management for per resource. So, and this is per domain basis. So it is up to the browser when they want to. You can just suggest them that cache this for until this time. But if you are caching everything, then they'll start ejecting, basically invalidating the previous resources. So be smart about it. Only cache the static resources mostly. And yeah, so that would be the tip on this. So do look into HTTP caching. Next would be CDNs. So CDNs stand for distributed networks, content delivery networks. So basically when you have these are optimized for delivering static resources to your clients. Think of images, think of documents that don't change that often. So inherently, because of the bandwidth cannot exceed for a particular distance after a certain point of time because of laws of physics. So the next step is just reducing the distance between the client and the server. So the CDNs provide you with that feature. So this is basically a geo-distributed network of servers. So, and when the client asks for the resource, the CDN basically will proxy the nearest server to the user. So the overall, the physical distance between the user and the server is now less. So the resource gets delivered faster. And also, because these are optimized for static resources, your server application code can focus on the dynamic parts of your application. So it's a win-win for the user and you. And bundling. So because HTTP, there's a limit to the connections that you can make to a server. Like your browser can make to the server. So if you are basically using a lot of resources on your page, there's a cap on the number of connections it can make. So if some resources belong together and it doesn't make sense to deliver them separately, like they would always need each other, bundle them together. So that will save a one round trip. So HTTP is stateless. So each time your client asks for a resource, a TCP new TCP connection has to be a new TCP connection is established, which is costly. So yeah, bundle your assets. So we'll go into a bit detail about later about this. So the next would be minification. So the more characters you send over the wire, the more bandwidth more data it will take. So in production, try to cut down on the amount of data that you're sending, and minification is one of the easiest way to cut down on the number of bytes you're sending over the wire. So yep. Another one is compression. So this is pretty big. So if you are hello. Can you mute yourself? Hello. Yeah. Coming back to compression. So this is something. So another way to decrease the payload size that you are sending over the wire is you compress the data, and the client then decompresses it on their side. So the overall bytes that traveled on the wire are lesser. So the major this is also can be set up just by changing the configuration for your web server. The major compression algorithms are gzip, and the new one is Protli. And yeah, you can use either of those. Some browsers don't support Protli, but they'll just fall back to, and it is also backward compatible. So all web servers will basically, if the client supports it, it will attach a header, deflate header to the request, and the server will know that it can send a compressed message. Otherwise, it will just send a non-compressed message. So you don't lose any user base, and you get some performance, and you save the user some bugs. So yeah, HTTP2. So it has been a long, HTTP2 has gained a lot of traction, and all the modern browsers support HTTP2. So it provides you with a lot of new features. The major one out of them is channel multiplexing. So it can use a single TCP channel to basically do multiple requests and download multiple resources in parallel using a single TCP connection. So as we talked about, there's a cap on the number of connections you can make. So this makes things a lot faster, and it is backward compatible again. So if you enable HTTP2 on your web server, the clients that don't support HTTP2 still can access your resources. It also provides you with some other things like server-sent events, but those are kind of features that don't add to performance. Yep. So
one doubt actually.
Yes.
So can we send many requests? There is no limit in HTTP2.
There's a cap on the connections. So previously, the case was one connection meant one request response. So HTTP2 multiplexes it, but still you have a fixed amount of there's a cap on bandwidth, and there's a cap on multiplexing also. So you end of the day has a fixed bandwidth, and the server can take only so much load. So it is not unlimited, but it will use the same connection for multiple resources now. So yeah, it is not unlimited. basically.
So why we have that we have a limit on that HTTP2 connection.
Mm-hmm.
Why we have a limit on that multiplexing, sir? Why can't we allow for
after a point, each channel has only so much bandwidth. So it comes down to your like lower layer TCP/IP and your like the network card you are using. Like end of the day, your frame there's only your network card has a frame buffer and it can only take so much data. So even if you are downloading 100 resources and taking one byte each from each of the resources, you can only take into account basically parallelly download only so much that your buffer can store. So does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So coming back to images. So images are a large part of they are the major media that is consumed in the applications, and they contribute to a large by and large to the bandwidth and payload size of the application. So they are a nice target to basically cut down if you are trying to like cut down your overall payload of your application. So and how to do that? So GIFs, basically videos are more lighter than GIFs in general. After a certain point of time, yeah. So GIFs are basically really bad at compression. And so you might as well use a video. And also one more thing with GIF is you cannot pause them. So GIFs is basically the frames are rendering, right? It needs to render the next frame. So the more GIFs you have on the page, the more it takes CPU cycles to render them. So, and the user cannot pause it. So you are basically forcing the user to use those CPU cycles. The video can be paused at least. And it is also, if compressed properly, the video would be smaller. Another one is sprite sheets. So you can, if a page requires a set of images that would always be used together, you can combine them in a single image and send it over and use crop it on the front and kind of make a box and position it such that only a part of the sprite sheet is shown. So then you will basically save up on a round trip. And compression, so compress your images accordingly. So multiple sizes, we'll go to the multiple sizes bit later. But yeah, make sure your assets are compressed in general. So this is different from the compression we talked about previously. That was on the fly compression that your web server will do. And this is your media format compression. So this is something you would do on a batch job kind of way, not for each request. You will process the assets upfront and then serve them. Use modern formats. They have a lot of advantages. So WebP is the current recommended one. So yeah, try to use you can have fallbacks. We'll talk about it later. So do make sure you are using the modern formats. They are smaller and more performant. Coming to network, so this is the something that you would need to write some code for. So service workers are basically a API provided by web browsers that will allows you to intercept network requests from your application. So there's a cache API that the browsers provide that you can use with this. And coupled these two, you can basically create your own caching layer in between using this. So in HTTP, you can just specify HTTP caching, you can just specify a timestamp. It is pretty declarative. Here you can write, you can actually write like logic inside, write code and then on the fly decide if you want to download the resource or serve it from the cache. So it is more customizable, but again, it requires JavaScript, and it also is not supported on older browsers, and you need to write some code, rather than it would need significantly more code to implement a service worker rather than adding some HTTP headers. So that concludes our network part. Anybody has any questions regarding the network thing, something particular they have in mind? Okay, so we can move on. So the next is, so once the, hello? So once the payload gets delivered to your browser, then these are the constraints. There is CPU, there's memory and battery. So we don't think about that as developers that much. So when tables have turned, so there are more mobile users that access your applications from mobile rather than people who, the number of people that access your applications from desktop and laptops. So battery becomes a major concern in this case. People don't notice it right now, but they'll start to soon probably. So one is CPU. So these handheld devices aren't as capable because of their size and size constraints. So, and also they don't cost as much as a laptop. So, and there are different tiers of these. So the lowest tier one won't have as fast as a CPU as the upper tier ones, but you should strive to make your application available, accessible to all of them. So second is another thing is memory. Again, it basically is the same criteria as the CPU. All devices are not the same, and some will have more memory and some will have less. If the devices have less memory and you are caching unnecessary stuff, it will be evicted. So be smart about what you are caching, how you are using the memory, and don't do memory leaks. Try to not to do memory leaks. So what do we do? How do we do this? So only send what is needed, and this can be done via tree shaking. So tree shaking is basically when you are creating bundles for your application. Most of the bundlers you can configure in such a way that they can remove the code from the libraries that is not being used by your application code. So it cuts down on overall bundle size. So this is something that you would need to look at in your bundling pipeline, but it is worth the effort. A second thing is we have to support, if your application has to support legacy browsers, you will need to add some, you would be using some new frameworks and APIs that aren't supported by the legacy browsers, and you would be using some polyfills to basically make the same application run on the legacy browser. But if you use the same bundles for the modern and legacy browsers, then you're basically adding a penalty for people using the modern browsers. They are downloading the polyfill even though they don't need it. So try to use different bundles for legacy and modern browsers. And the next one is route-based chunking. So if you are using a client-based router, or this takes the previous approach a step further, rather than having different bundles for each for modern and legacy browsers, have different bundles for different pages. So this can be done on the server side, or if you are using a client-side router, then also. So it requires, if you are doing it on the client side, then it requires figuring this out in your framework also, and also in your bundler. And if you are doing it on server side, then you just need to fiddle with your bundler and make different, basically generate different versions of your application and JavaScript bundles for different pages. So yeah, that way you will only send what is needed to the user and not anything more. Another one is prioritization. So prioritize the critical resources. So because as we talked about, there's a cap on the number of connections and the bandwidth. You will have to decide what you want to deliver first, what you want to deliver later. Things will need to, everything cannot be in parallel. So for that, some tips are inlining critical CSS. So the page, there's no flash of flash of refresh when the style sheet loads in future, and HTML loads first. So then the styles will be recalculated and it will be repainted. So it comes as a flash for the user, and it is not healthy for people having some conditions. So it is also accessibility issue. So I keep that in mind. So to inline your critical CSS. And another one is resource hints. Resource hints are some attributes that you can add to your link tags. Basically, you can instruct the hint the browser about the priority of the resource, or load resources in a certain priority order using different attributes. We'll talk about it in the next slide. Async and defer. So yeah, this is something that is added for the script tag. So this again, by default, the scripts are downloaded sequentially and executed. It doesn't wait for the document doesn't parallelly keeps getting downloaded. The DOM doesn't get created in the background. If a script is being downloaded, everything stops for it. So that makes your page load times pushes up your page load times. So if something isn't needed at that point in time, but later, use async and defer based on what type of resource, what is the criticality of the resource. Async is something you would want to use independent things. So something like a Google Analytics script, which is not a critical part of your application and functions independently. Defer is something in which you would want to place your, probably the main vendor bundle of your application in that mode. So lazy loading modules. So yeah, this is again something that is supported by the ES6 module system, and you will have to configure your bundler using this. So using certain syntax, using the import function syntax, you can your bundle can basically download the modules on a need to basically when it needs them, rather than delivering the whole bundle in one go. So you progressively add features to the application rather than parsing the whole thing in one go and then waiting. Then the user has to wait for the whole thing to complete executing for the first interaction. Another thing is image loading lazy. This landed comparatively recently. So this adds first class support for lazy loading images in the browser. So you don't need any library for the modern browsers. If you add this attribute, basically your image will automatically be lazy loaded if it is below the fold. Picture tag allows you to basically specify multiple sources, and the browser will basically pick up the best source based on the viewport bandwidth and the formats it supports out of those sources that you have specified. So you give choice to your user based on the condition or environment or device they are on. They'll get the best content for that environment rather than one size fits all approach. Next one is image source set. So these two attributes combined, source sets and sizes, allows you to basically make your images responsive. So this will basically what you will do, you will in source set you can specify multiple URLs for different sizes of the same images, and in sizes you can specify the viewports that they map to. So you can basically give a list of URLs and a list of sizes, and based on the screen size of the user, the particular resource will be loaded. So here you have a one-to-one control over at which viewport size, which size of image you want to load. So yeah, so these are some ways in which you can prioritize your resource delivery. Bundling and compression aren't free. So parsing JS takes as we talked about at the end of the day, it is a single threaded environment, and the world will stop for the user when your bundle is getting executed. They won't be able to interact with the application. So the modern browsers have already added support for module syntax. So you can, if your application is targeted at those environments, then you don't need to use a bundler per se. So then you can avoid the bundling cost. So the bundler adds a lot of scaffolding around your modules, and it basically increases the parsing time of the overall application. But previously we didn't have a choice. So now we do, at least for some environments. So be mindful about with what audience you are serving and choose accordingly. Decompressing takes CPU cycles. And so that is also something that you need to keep in mind. So regarding decompression, so if the payload is smaller than a certain size, particular size, decompression can actually bulk up, increase your size on the wire. So it then in that case it is you lose on both sides. You are transferring more data over the wire, and also you are paying the decompression computing cost. So the web servers allow you to set a minimum payload size after which below which they would always send the non-decompressed response rather than a compressed response. So this can be easily dealt with, but keep in mind these things have a CPU memory, CPU and battery cost for the user. So this is the last thing that I'll touch on. So keep it interactive. So even the this is the closest thing for your day to day. This is the hardest thing to do because you'll have to incorporate in your day to day routine and have to think about it while writing application code. So if you write a lot of blocking code, the user, it is a single threaded environment, and the render event loop will block, and because of that the next frame won't be painted. If the user hovers over something, they click a button, it will have to wait until the task you are doing in the main thread is completed. So it is not a really good experience. So there are multiple new APIs that you can use to multiple new alternatives that you can use to basically schedule your work more efficiently. So request animation frame is something that executes just before the next paint cycle. So in that you can do your DOM manipulations, and it makes sure that it happens just before the paint cycle happens. So you can be sure that you are just making the DOM changes, and they would appear as soon as you make them, and there won't be any mutations in between. Request idle callback is something that has been added recently and still experimental. So this is again something, so this will, you can pass it a callback and the browser will execute it when the main thread is basically when the resources are, it has resources and the user isn't doing anything. Maybe they are just reading something on the screen. So this can be used for stuff that is really not core to your application, like if you want to track activity, user cursor movements for analytics or something, or any background things. One really interesting thing is web workers. So if you really have some, if you really have some chunky payload, like a large amount of CPU intensive work that needs to be done, and it doesn't have to interact with the DOM. You're not changing something visually, you are just doing some core computations, then you can use offload that task to web workers. So that is something you can use, basically spawn multiple web workers and do some things in the background, and you can listen to them and they can send back the computed data to the main thread, and then you can use that data to basically change the UI. So yeah, so that is the end of it. We'll be taking questions now. So there's something on the chat. So somebody wrote GIFs on 9GAC can be paused. So those are videos. They convert those to videos.
Chirag, we have some questions on chat. Can you please check YouTube chat?
Okay, YouTube chat. I don't have that open. One second. Can you ping the link
I'll just do.
One second. Meanwhile, anybody on the call has a question, they can. Okay.
So have you seen the YouTube link, Chirag?
Yep. I got it. Yeah. So we'll go through. So there's how to manage more HTTP requests in a particular period of time. So this depends on the client to client and the kind of bandwidth the client has. So this is the trade-off that you have to face in when you're working on the client side. You don't have control over the environment your code executes in. So this is mostly something you would need to handle. Like, it is up to the client how much connections they want to try opening, how much requests they want to make in parallel to your to the server. The only thing you can do is make sure your server has enough capacity to deal with more requests. There's nothing much you can do about it to basically increase the number of connections or the number of requests that can be made in a specific by a certain domain. So that is capped by the platform. Because otherwise, if you have multiple tabs open, one of the applications can take all of the bandwidth, and other applications will become unresponsive, which breaks down the whole concept of sandboxing on the web. So somebody is asking, can you please refer to some resources for network. I don't have anything on top of my mind right now. So some resources for network. So the PWA workshop, or I don't know what, on the Google Web Developers blog is pretty thorough. So just go through the Google Developers Web Fundamentals or web.dev case studies. So there are a lot of articles there around the same. They talk about it, and they also have a YouTube channel. Do subscribe to it. They post about it regularly. And yeah, I think those are the two questions there. Yep. So anybody else?
Sir, how CDN works?
CDN works as in, can you elaborate? So there like are how, like a lot of
so suppose you have a server, okay, setting somewhere around the world, okay. Suppose Google is having server in America, how it is delivering its product in India?
That is, so CDN is a network of multiple servers. It is not a single server. So when you upload a file to a CDN, it gets broadcasted to, like, it's this kind of a decentralized cluster, multiple decentralized clusters, you can say. So the when you upload it, the server you upload it knows where all other servers are, and it will send the file to those servers, and the file will get uploaded, updated on those servers. And when the lookup happens, so there's a DNS lookup, right? That happens in between. So the CDN service that you are using, you're using the same link for every user because the link is static. So when that link hits the CDN service for that particular region, it maps to the IP in that, the server IP for that region. So it is mostly a cluster of servers geographically located at multiple locations with a service that can broadcast resources to it and route requests according to. So it is for region thing, it is it first hits a service which reroutes it. And because it is a like a DNS lookup isn't for a session, it doesn't get invalidated. So for the next request, if it is from the same CDN, suppose you are loading two images from the same CDN, for the first one it will need to get the IP, for the second one it will make the request directly. So does that clarify things?
And sir, scalability issues which we face while if your web app is small now, right now you are getting more users, so how you will scale it up? Like, we have horizontal scaling, vertical scaling, and then partitioning the databases. So how it is done?
So that really depends on the kind of traffic you are facing. So all parts of your application won't be getting the similar traffic. And there would be some features. So there would be some features that would be used more by the user. So you need to optimize for your use case, or which way you want to push the users, which things you want them to use more. And some, like, it depends also the way you have written the code. If you have, there is some feature that is written in a way it cannot be broken down further, so then, or it cannot be, it needs a central data store, then it cannot be horizontally scaled unless you will again need something to coordinate in between. You would need something like eventually a consistent thing. And vertical scaling has its own problem. Like, you cannot if you have a single server that is has a large amount of computing power and memory, then you again you cannot have, those are expensive and you cannot have multiple of those at different geographical locations. So it is a trade-off and it depends on the type of application, the way you have written your code, the depends, like the you talked about sharding, it depends on your database schema. You might not, if you cannot find a like good enough key to shard your database, you cannot shard it.
So how will determine that APIs are carrying lightweight data, like we use JSON to structure it. So how will determine that APIs are carrying like lightweight data and the network will not have any problems with that?
So first of all, as we talked about, don't send anything that you don't need. So load your page, check all the API responses, see if any fields, there are any fields that that are in the API that are not being used on that page. So those can be eliminated. And otherwise, we talked about a lot of things like compression. So compression also network, like compression over network also works for API calls. So the web server that is serving your API calls, you can enable HTTP2 in compression on that side. And yeah, and there are other different formats. So if the data size is large, you cannot cut down on it. You can use something like a binary JSON format, and then on the client side, you will have to decompress it.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, any other questions? Let's stop sharing this. So I think we have 2 more minutes. We can take one last question if anybody has something. Okay then. So yeah, I think that would be, we can close this. Yeah. So thanks everyone.
Thank you so much for joining and thanks for your time. Thank you audience. Thank you for joining the session.
Yeah. Thank you everyone.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Yogesh. Thank you, Gobi, for organizing this.